Welcome everybody. Welcome to my teaching learning session of bachelor's program. I am Sonal Singh Pawar and taking care of psychology courses for bachelors in April. We will be continuing our course today with theories of motivation. To give you a quick review of what we did the last time was, what is motivation? Motivation is the drive that leads us to completion of a goal. And further, we started with a lot of theories. So we will begin with a revision of the first three theories that we started with. The last time we completed three theories. One theory was theory of evolution, the drive theory, which also states about, you know, pushing you towards a goal, and an optimal arousal model theory. Speaking of evolutionary theory, evolutionary process and theory stated for us that in the beginning, the drive, the motivation and the drive is determined as an innate characteristic. That means it is determined, our goal and our behavior are manifested because we are born with it. We are born with a drive to complete a process, complete a goal. For example, for humans being born in the world, if we want our lineage to continue, we actually reproduce and procure further so that our lineage and our process of human life keeps going on. So that was an evolutionary approach, the first approach, which kind of ends up being very prime, and when ends up being very prime, it does not have much explanation of what drive is, what is motivation, and why are we motivated, and these innate characteristics is leading to a behavior which are called instincts. So this is the first theory. Then we came to something which was the second, which was the drive theory of motivation. This is one of those approaches of motivation which suggests that we have a need which creates a psychological tension within us, and this tension then further drives us to reduce this tension, we move towards goal fulfillment. So, for example, there's a tension to complete your task at work, or probably there's a tension to sit for an examination. To do that, it will create a psychological thought, which will be to study continuously, consistently studying, consistently working hard, making a timetable for yourself, and further making you lead to completion of your course before your examination. So this is how it moves from having a need. The need is to sit for the paper, and that creates a psychological tension where you need to prepare yourself well. You need to mark your timetable, create a timetable, function accordingly, complete your task, and further leading to completion of your theory or your course, and then sit for your examination. So this was ideally called as the, this psychological tension was called by Hull as the drive. So here he explained what is the drive. The drive is the psychological tension which is arising in your mind when you have a need which is impending, which is a need that you need to fulfill. The theories also suggest that this actually states that the behavior is pushed. So it's like a push theory. The drive pushes you to complete something. So it arouses that need. That need arouses that drive, which is the psychological tension. And that psychological tension pushes you to complete the goal. So when you are pushed towards completion of the goal, this theory is called as the push theory. Then we came to the last third one, which we did the last time, which was called the optimal arousal model. So speaking of optimal arousal model, which was given by Yorkson Dodson, you can see this model of his. It's a very simple model. You can check it out, the image also, which is in front of you. And this model was also called as Yorkson and Dodson law. It was very famous post the evolutionary approach and the push theory. Yorkson and Dodson's theory was very popular, and that's why it was also called a law, which is Yorkson and Dodson's law. This simply stated we function best when we are moderately energized, neither too much or neither too low. That means we can take an example during our examinations also. When you are too aroused, which is when there is too much of anxiety, this too much of anxiety will not let you function properly. It will not give you results which are great, which is it will lead to too much of overthinking, worrying consistently, and too less of arousal, which is you will feel very, you know, you procrastinate the entire need to study on time. You reduce the importance of your examination. You sit and study where the completion of your course will not happen because you're not serious enough for it. So that is low arousal. So neither higher arousal and lower arousal will lead to completion and motivated goal directed behavior, but a very adequate amount, an optimal level of arousal will lead to a good performance. So optimal level is the key point here, and it is stated as optimal arousal model also. When it is too less, remember there's going to be boredom, less seriousness, lack of interest, which is apathy, as stated in the figure. And then when it is too much, which the arousal is too high, there is going to be a lot of anxiety, there's going to be a lot of overthinking, so the quality of performance goes down. So the quality of performance will stay good when you are optimally aroused. From this, let's move to other theories of motivation, which is the incentive theory. So like the other where we spoke about the push theory, incentive theories were like a pull theory, which is this theory suggested, like the term incentive, motivation is a result of a desire to achieve an external reward or probably something which is given by an external source to you, simply an incentive. Like a lot of people in multinational companies are working year to year, they're very determined to achieve goals, targets and projects because we know there's going to be a promotion by the end of the year and there's going to be appraisals. So this is what is motivating them, that incentive in mind is motivating them to complete a goal and be motivated to complete a goal. So that is called the pull theory. And it was given by Morgan et al. Et al. Means there were many more psychologists along with Morgan in 1996. The theory is not very old. The theory is quite new in terms of incentive theories. And under incentive theories, there are a large amount of other theories also that are there. But incentive per se is an umbrella term for the theories. Then moving to the other, this speaks about cognitive approaches to motivation. Speaking of cognitive approaches, remember, let's understand the term cognition. I hope everyone remembers. Cognition is a process of knowing and thinking. So it will include the process like decision making, problem solving, perception, attention, memory. So all the belief that you have, anything that creates a thought, anything that creates a belief system would be cognition. So the theory is based on the cognitive part of motivation, which suggests us that motivation is a result of the thought and belief expectation that you hold and the goal that you hold. So thus, this was given by Fedman in 2015, which is again very close, and I've even written the page number so that you can actually go down to your books also, which is 289. So thus, for example, let's take an example. There's a student who's motivated to study for examination based on the expectation that he or she will get great marks. Similarly, let's take an example of a student who knows that I do not have the ability to do this paper. I probably lack the ability. They lack the expectation. They lack the thought about reasoning. They reason that I cannot do this paper well. I will not be able to perform. Even if I perform, I will not be excelling in it. So this suggests that the cognition regarding a task is lesser. So thinking, reasoning, problem solving, your attention, perception, your belief and expectation is lesser. That's why you are not motivated for that task. Similarly, when we talk about cognitive approach model, it suggests the belief system actually leads you to motivate towards a goal or a task. So this is called as cognitive approaches to motivation. Now, the next is the goal setting theory. Very appropriate, and I feel in today's life, goal setting theory is something that we all are moving accordingly. Something which is driving our behavior of every day, which was proposed by Locke and Latham in 1998. So they propose that your motivation is just influenced by the goals that you create. So if a task or probably is in an entire day, if you have a goal which is set up, remember your body and mind is going to be more motivated towards that day and to complete that task. And at the same time, if on this, you know, on the same day you do not have a goal, you do not have a target behavior, you do not have something that you have to look upon, remember at that point of time, your body and mind is not going to be motivated. There isn't going to be a drive that you want to fulfill, a need which is deficient, and you would not lead to a goal-directed behavior accordingly. So the theorists conclude from these studies that people perform better on tasks when they know there is a specific goal. You can also, as students, try it in yourself. The day that you sit for your examination and you do not have a specific goal in mind that I need to complete this amount of chapters, you vaguely sit and start reading. Remember, it will not lead to a proper completion of the course or proper completion of any relevant amount of number of targets that you want to do. So having a specific goal, a relevant goal, measurable goal, something like that, like specific goals that we talk about, something which is specific, something which is relevant, goal-directed, has time-bound, is something that can be, that is something which is going to motivate you and achieve further better performance. Now let's move to the hierarchical model. Hierarchical model is similar to Maslow's theory. When we speak about Maslow's theory spoke about, five of our needs, which speaks about five needs going from the lower deficit need to the higher needs. I do not have the page of Maslow because we have a very similar theory as per Maslow, which was the Earth's theory that will come into play. We've already done this theory of Maslow of hierarchy of needs. The theory is the same, which says that we have five needs, starting from the lower needs. The lower needs are deficient in nature. That's why it leads to the other. So we begin with physiological needs. We then move to safety needs, from safety to belonging, belonging to esteem needs. And then finally is the highest need, which is called the self-actualization need. It's called the higher order need, whereas all the other three, four are called the lower order need. So we always start from lower needs to the upper need. Remember, we never go down the pyramid. You will never go down the triangle from the upper to the lower need. You will always move from the lower needs to the higher needs. This completes with the most famous hierarchical model of Maslow as a theory, which we've done earlier. And let's move to more theories. As I said, there are many theories. Now let's move to another bunch of theories, which is called self-determination, self-theory of motivation, and Adelfer's ERG theory. Adelfer's ERG theory was very similar to Maslow's. Let's start with self-determination theory, which was given by Ryan and Edward Deci in 2000. Again, a very closely done theory at 2000, which is not very old. This theory states that there are three innate and universal needs. So innate is something that you're born with, and universal, that it's all common to all of us. So me sitting here will also have these needs, and you as students will also have the needs. So apart the status, apart the kind of work that you're doing, and apart from the strata, we all comprise of these universal and innate needs, which helps us in gaining a sense of individuality, a sense of self, and building a very healthy relationship with others. So here, the self-determination theory is ending with what? It is ending with leading to you to achieve something, which is a sense of self and a sense of a healthy relationship with others. So what is the goal in this theory? What are you motivated to do by the end? You are motivated to achieve a sense of self. A sense of self will have that you have a better perception of yourself among people. You know yourself well. You can rank yourself well. Your self-esteem is good, and you're able to control your processes. And at the same time, it also speaks about healthy behavior, which is by the end, there's another goal, which is building healthy relationships and behaviors with others. So what are these three innate universal needs, which is common to all of us? One is competence, the other is autonomy, and the last one that we speak about after autonomy is relatedness. Relatedness is a very new thing which will come in the theories of motivation. Autonomy, we all know, autonomy is a sense of controlling and choosing your behaviors, choosing the task that you want to do, and in a simple pattern, controlling your behavior, your ability to control behavior. Competency is your, again, an ability to master a task or master a challenge that you put forth. And relatedness refers to a sense of belongingness and a sense of forming a sense of relationship with a group, a secure belonging relationship, which could be any group that you're associated with. So just to feel related with others would be something which is relatedness. So what is the agenda of this theory? This theory comes with the thought that we are motivated to complete these needs, which are innate and universal in nature, which will lead to a sense of self and a healthy relationship. Let's move to other theory, which is the self theory of motivation. Very similar to the other one, because we are talking about self again. It was given by Carl Jung in 1999, just a year before the self-determination theory. It says that it proposes that the need for achievement is actually related to your personality factors. And the need for achievement is influenced by your perception of self, which is very true. How you achieve things and what you achieve is greatly influenced by how do you perceive yourself amongst others, how do you perceive your abilities, and how you perceive your relationship with others. You know, usually you will see all of the motivation theories are very well applicable in organizational system of ours. Also in counseling, but I would say that 70% of these theories are applicable in the organizational system to take care of the upliftment of employees, to have a better relationship. It talks about bonding, relation, teamwork, which is mostly seen in an organizational system. So even when we talk about this theory of self, also states that this is influenced by your need for achievement. And these need of achievement is influenced by the perception of you, your abilities, and your perception with the kind of relationships that you form with others. Also, this affects the way you are succeeding and, you know, looking onto a task as failure and success. This approach is very closely related to locus of control. Locus of control can be two kinds, internal and external. So how does the theory of self-associate to something which is locus of control. So theory of self suggests us that we are, the need of achievement is very closely related to personality factors. So if you feel that the need of achievement is associated to your personality factors, personality brings about self within it. So personality is a bigger term, which has self-awareness, self-perception, your ability of self in relationship with others. That indirectly impacts your achievement, and that achievement also gives you a vision of how do you, what do you call as failure and what do you call as success. And this directly, indirectly is associated to Rorty's concept of locus of control. Locus of control is something where is the target of all your behaviors and experiences. Are they internally making you happen, or is it externally? So let's take an example. If someone who has an internal locus of control, remember, these people do not require a pat on the back. They do not require too much of external motivation. If they decide that this task is something which is very relevant to them, an achievement of this task will lead to probably, a frame of autonomy somewhere, or probably ascribed status, a status that they will achieve, they will be working on their own. Whereas when we talk about an external locus of control is completely driven by people outside, because we're speaking about external people. So external locus of control states that it is driven by people outside, or items, things, reinforcement, reward from outside. It could be, the day that you're probably going for a presentation or interview, the weather is really amazing, and you end up finding all the commutation and the place of work very easily. So it gives you a positive vibe, but again, it's from external source, not internally. Internally would be feeling confident, feeling that I can achieve it and I can do it. So that is internal, and the other that I told, lateral, was something which is external. That is again greatly related with achievement, because yes, how do you want to achieve something externally or internally does impact on your achievements. So this finishes with theory of motivation and determination, which is quite similar to one another. And let's move to the other one, which is Alderfer ERG theory. This ERG theory also has a pyramid, which you see on the picture over there. It is very similar to what you call as Maslow's theory, but the terminologies have been changed. When we talk about E, E is existence, R is relatedness, and G is growth. So E would be existence is something which is, taking care of the last three needs of Maslow, which talks about physiology, safety, love, and belongingness. Whereas when we talk about relatedness is something which will associate you to having a belonging feature with somebody, feeling loved, feeling esteemed, which is like, let's take an example of an organization only. ERG theory was developed by an American psychologist, Clayton Alderfer. And it's essentially very close to Maslow's theory, because we use the same need terminology and replace it to something else. So in a workplace, for example, you love the workplace, you feel identified, you feel very safe with people there, and you love the package that you're getting. So don't you feel your existence gets sticked there because you're feeling physiologically safe and there's a lot of safety in that environment. You feel very secure. Now let's move to something which is relatedness. At the same place, you are loved with people. You're in the cultural group of the organization. You're the one who actually is the MC in the most of the events. So you're very recognized. So there is self-esteem. There's a sense of belongingness also that is coming to you. And the last is the growth. Growth is the final need and the highest need again, which suggests that once you're able to take care of the existence and related need, you will end up growing, which is moving towards your self-actualization, which is moving towards your highest potential. Self-actualization also suggests that also means reaching to your highest potential. So there are three levels. The hierarchy isn't of five in comparison to Maslow, but three. And we start from the lower needs and we move to the upper need. Also, these theories are moved in the organizational, used in the organizational system, and you will be finding it applied at the workplaces to increase the productivity of the employees. A lot of motivation boost that you require for your employee, if these theories can be used there, keeping in mind the ERG, which is existence, relatedness, and growth. This completes, and it's one of the most famous theory also, after Maslow's theory. Very relevant. Maslow's theory is very well applicable in organization system, and is also ERG that you will find. People think in the similar pattern, not consciously, but subconsciously. We all in the organization system are looking to growth by the end, but first looking for pay packages, also looking for safety and looking for your growth. and looking for your, you know, your love and belongingness with people there, the environment is good, you stick to that place and further that you grow. So this is ERG theory that completes with these three sets. Now let's move to something which is the last two theories that we have, which is Herzberg's two-factor theory and Mictlan's acquired need. You see two pictures over here. Hope that will help you understand the theories better. When we speak about Herzberg's two-factor theory, it says that we are motivated because of two factors in the organizational system that can reach lead to satisfaction and dissatisfaction in an individual. So speaking of the two factors, one is the motivational factors that we have and the other is the hygiene factors. Remember, motivational factors would be something which is more associated to your tasks, to your goals, to your achievements. And hygiene factors would be factors which are associated to the kind of conditions, the amenities available at the workplace. You know, people do not have a cafeteria at their workplace. They find it very uncomfortable because you do not get any extra eateries to have over there. If there are no cleaner washrooms at places that you work, they find it uncomfortable. So these leads to what? It leads to low motivation in an individual. So these two factors actually leads to satisfaction and dissatisfaction in the two forms. Let's tick down all the motivational factors. It's achievement, recognition, the work that you're doing itself. So remember, a lot of people leave their jobs because they find that their work is not motivating, which is that their work does not involve a good number of hours and the core of the work is not getting completed. So their task is not completed. They do not enjoy their work. They feel the work itself is not very relevant. Also responsibility, advancement and growth. These are some motivational factors that will provide satisfaction to people in their workplace. And there are some other hygiene factors also that will both provide satisfaction and dissatisfaction like the others. Like hygiene factors will include factors like supervision, eating outlets, it could be work conditions, it could be hygiene condition, it could be also salary packages, the security of that place. You know, a lot of young buds, which is young children like you, if you join work, I'm sure, you know, the first few things that these people see in today's generation, not only the package and salary, but also the amenity and the facility provided by the work area. The work areas are not clean. The desks are not keeping clean. You do not find proper security systems around work, which is if the working organization is at an aloof area, an area where there is no commutation, an area that you probably have to commute for 15 to 20 kilometers each day on and off. There are times that people are dissatisfied, they are not motivated to work, and they end up leaving work. So this is a Herzberg's two-factor theory, again, a quite famous theory that we have, and it's very relatable. Now let's come to the last theory, which is Mictlan's acquired needs theory. This theory stated, it was developed by Mictlan in 1961, and it was just extended in 87 by three factors. They highlighted three needs that we are always urging to complete. So Mictlan's theory of needs says that we need to complete all these three needs, and they are associated to an abbreviation also, which is NARC, NARF, and NPAF, which is PAF is the power. So NARC is the achievement, and need for achievement, NARF is the need for affiliation, and NPAF is the need for power. So when we speak about the need of achievement, this talks about your drive to excel somewhere. Move from one step or one post to the other horizontally, not vertically, like moving up the ladder in terms of your work organization. Then there's a need of power, which is the power not only to influence people at times, but also control people, and also a desire to do things, get things done by other people, do and done by others, which is, power over others. So this will you'll find as power is something which is over other people, influencing other people, getting your work done by other people. And the last that we speak about is the need for affiliation. So they stated that in an organizational system or probably in a state of motivation, these three needs are extremely important. Need for achievement, need for power, and need for affiliation. So need for affiliation is the need for, getting associated to a group. In a work organization, finding a partner who's like-minded, who is equally hardworking as you, is something which is need of affiliation. It could be a good friendship, a good relationship. These are also can be associated our daily needs to keep going on, our daily needs, which leads to motivation to keep going on each day. So your need for achievement makes us go to office every day, makes us go to colleges every day, attend classes every day. Then our need for affiliation makes us be present in the college every day. the fact that your friends are coming every day and they are very regular with their attendance, that also influences you. So their need for power and your need for affiliation. So this completes with the theories of motivation. Let's just like quickly review it. We started with what was motivation. We did a motivation cycle that tells us how does motivation keeps going on. And it starts from drive. Drive leads to an arousal. Arousal takes you to achievement of a task. That task will lead to the lesser of arousal, and it goes back to the need. So it's a cycle that goes on. After that, we did some few of the important theories, which are here today, which are to the 12 theories that we had, and which includes the evolutionary theory, optimal arousal, and then we came to something which was cognitive theories of approach, self-determination, Maslow's theory, ERG theory, Hertzberg's and McClellan. This completes with an entire chunk of motivation today and makes us shift to a new topic that talks about emotion. Let's understand why motivation and emotion is such an important thing after this. Let's move to new topics now. After that, we will touch motivation and emotion. Let me just give you a little introduction before we move to motivation, after motivation to emotion. Remember, why are we associating emotion after this topic of frustration and conflict? That is, motivation and emotion are one of the most paramount things in our life that actually changes our behavior. Changes your behavior to be positive. If you are driven and you're motivated, and if your moods are bad and spoiled, you do not reach towards the goal. So that's why they are related and associated in your book also. That's why the book also suggests the block three that I'm doing right now, which is motivation and emotion. Now let's come down to something as conflict and frustration. So speaking of conflict and frustration, why do we need to talk about it? We need to talk about it because when we are motivated, there are times that there are hurdles in between a task. There are tasks which are not getting completed, and it is leading to a lot of frustration for us. And the drive is getting frustrated. The drive is getting irritated and leading to, blockages of goal, and which further results in frustration. And your cycle, which is motivatedly goingly as a sink like this, it turns back because of frustration and come to square one. So what does frustration does to us and to our goals and to our task? Frustration is, whenever there's a goal-directed behavior which is blocked due to any reason. It could be a reason which is self, it could be a reason which is an external reason, which leads to a psychological situation called frustration. So frustration arises when your goal is obstructed and it's blocked. And what are the sources? What are the kind of sources that we were, reasons that we were kind of talking about? It could be environmental forces. Environmental forces could be user also. Which is, it could be a natural calamity. It could be a physical place that you're staying in. Smaller areas, very closely knit buildings, do not have places to play. So a child can be frustrated when he or she does not get good amenities to play outside, doesn't have people around, have elderly people around, and kids are not there. So that is a sense, that does dwell a sense of frustration in children when they find that the place that they're living in does not have kids there, and there are elderly people maximum. So that's like because of an environmental factor. Also, places which are extremely cold and extremely hot can also lead to a lot of frustration during work. Then there are personal factors. Personal factors could be something which is, it could be your ability, intelligence, your personality. People being very aggressive, in their temperament can lead to a lot of frustration. Because, your temperament being very hot and very, very aggressive, and you're very argumentative, this can lead to frustration when you're doing a team activity and teamwork. You want to head everything. That doesn't happen. We need to collaborate and work. So these are some personal factors that can actually lead to frustration. And there is another factor which is associated to frustration as a unique topic, as a holistic topic, which is called conflict. When does this conflict arise from? Conflict is arising when there are contradictory motives or motives which are very alike, and you need to choose between. So that's also a reason for conflict, a reason for frustration. Like, for example, if you want to go to a party and you want to go to a celebration in your house and you don't want to miss both of them, this will lead to frustration. We'll keep thinking the entire day what to do, what not to do. And, it will lead to a lot of overthinking. At the same time, it could be you had a fight with a friend. Should I be talking to a friend or should I not be talking to a friend? So it's also a conflict of the positives and the negatives. This also leads to a lot of frustration. Speaking of frustration, we need to know frustration is very closely associated to aggression. A lot of studies have suggested that at times when the mind is very frustrated, it does lead to aggression in the physical body. So when we talk about aggression in the physical body, it says that, you know, the theorem says frustration aggression displacement theory. This hypothesis states that blocking of a goal, which is frustration, causes a lot of aggression. In other form, the aggression is a result of frustration. We can see it in our daily activities when children are fighting with one another, and the fight starts with a verbal, you know, outlay of aggression, simple verbal outlay of aggression, which is like one abuses the other. The other says pinchingly something really bad that hits somebody below the belt, and the physical activity starts. Even the aggression can start in a verbal pattern, or it can start probably in revenge taking, and also at times it could be physical. So frustration and aggression hypothesis suggests that aggression is a result of frustration to us. Now let's move to conflict, which was also a factor that leads to frustration. So let's talk about, when we talk about conflict, is something which happens when there is a you know, choice that you need to make between contradictory motives, desires, or probably needs. What are the kind of different conflicts that we come across? There is approach, take it as positive. So when we're talking about approach, that means we like both the categories. Avoidance, then there is approach avoidance, and there is double approach and double avoidance, which is double approach avoidance. Moving to this, you will find approach conflicts would be when there are two desirable outcomes. Like I said, you want to attend a birthday party of your friend, and at the same time, there's a huge celebration which is happening at your own house. So it's such a difficult thing. Both are, you know, they're contradictory desires that you want to attend both of them, but now you need to be choosing. Relatively, it's said that these create lesser frustration because of the fact that they are both desirable outcomes, and it does not irritate the mind. It does not cause any sort of difficulty in the mind for a long term. Whereas when, let's move to the next one, which is avoidance approach. Let's move to avoidance approach, which is as per the paragraph that I've given. Approach avoidance suggests that there is one which is a very positive thing, the other is which is very unattractive. Let's take an example. Working at an area, and there's a workplace which is giving you a huge amount of incentive, which is beautiful, and the year is ending and you're getting an incentive, and you get an offer from other place also, which is way too far from your livability, like your residence. So a 20 kilometer away place, which is also very good in terms of its money, salary package, but you already are getting an incentive at your current place. So what will you move towards? You will move towards something which is more attractive. Remember, approach and avoidance is relatively very simple. Simple because it leads to lesser frustration. It leads to lesser overthinking and anxiety. In comparison to the next that I'm doing, which is avoidance, which is where you need to pick up between the two unattractive outcomes. Something which are not, the two desires which are both not liked for you. Like for children, not prepared for an examination, going to school and giving the examination. The students has to go to school also for a complete attendance, and they're not prepared and there is an examination in school. So they neither want to go to school, they neither want to give the examination. So they both are avoidance. Avoidance as in they want to avoid both the outcomes. This involves a huge amount of mental conflict. This involves a lot of frustration, a lot of anxiety in the individual. Also, at time, it could lead to other repercussions, which is long overterm overthinking. It could lead to, you know, a long-term anxiety that stays in the mind. If the child is always unprepared, let's take an example. There are a series of 7 examinations that the child has to attempt, and the child isn't prepared for them, but has to go to school and has to give papers. So both is like, I don't want to go to school, I don't even want to give my paper. So this is something that you need to choose. Either go to school and don't give the paper, give a medical, or probably go to school and give the paper. Also, this can take other features also in organizational system, where people are getting a project that they don't like, and at the same time stay with a work project which is incompatible. So you're already doing a task which is really incompatible to your ability. It actually is a very deficient task that you're doing, but now you're getting a task which is not of your liking and not of your choice. So both of them are unattractive outcomes. Either you stick to the task that you're already doing and say a no to that, or probably pick up a new task which is again something that you dislike and you is of not your interest. So they both are something which is avoidance. Now let's move to something which is the last, which is double or multiple approach and avoidance. Here you need to choose between multiple 2 things and 3 things, which could be multiple desirable things. Let's take an example. you know, children, when they're fighting and they're not doing well at work, they're not doing well at school, and they do not have a social group to vent to, and they do not have close friends, and they go to school. So in the school, they have this thing of, I don't like the class, I don't like the teacher, I have to sit in this, I have not even studied. And the other end, I don't have friends also in my class. So, you know, everything is something which is both are desirable and both are undesirable. So undesirable would be something which is, I do not have great friends, I do not like the teachers, I do not like the course that I'm studying. And probably the desirable would be, just sit home, I will do it on my own, I will sit home and do it with my own, or probably take my personal tuitions and take support from the online videos and, you know, online videos and theories that comes online, and read a lot. So this is like something for them, multiple approach. Staying home is so desirable, whereas going to school is so undesirable. Multiple undesirability. So it's multiple, which is double approach and double approach. So avoidance is talking about as undesirable, and approach is stating it as desirable, which is again taken as simple as positive negatives. These are the different kind of conflicts that we go through, which can, if increases in their intensity, can lead to frustration. Frustration could be a physical frustration also. It could also be psychological in nature and further leading to mental issues and illness. Now, completing conflicts, let's move to the last unit of this block, which is emotions. And emotions, a long unit, it will go on for a longer duration. Now, let's understand why emotion and motivation is suggested to be two sides of the coin. As I stated before, you know, without emotion, our tasks do lose the life into it, and life without motivation, it do lose the energy into it. So they actually play a very important role for you in your behaviors, to direct your behaviors, to make sure that your behaviors are goal directed and they are done well. So if you're not motivated in doing the task, remember how the goal is going to be. It's going to be something that you don't like. And for example, if you're not in a mood to do a task, your task does not look that appreciable to other people. So let's take an example of, you know, a creative project or profile making that you need to do. A child who's not really motivated, the profile building application or the application he or she feels is going to be just very theoretical. Whatever the questions ask and the answers are very platonic, very simple, very direct. At the same time, if you're not in a good mood, a project will be made without, you know, innovation, without creativity. Very simple, very cause and effect sort of a project will be made. So remember, being motivated and being emotionally involved is very important for a behavior to function well. So our behaviors are actually manifested by good emotions or whatever kind of emotions and motivations, low motivation, high motivation, that what brings changes in your motivation. Let's move to now, as in terms of what, when we talk about motivation and the work around it, Akam in 1980 suggested us that there was a seminal work which was done on facial expression and proposed there are six basic emotions. On the basis of what? On the basis of the facial features that came into play. So what you see on face, according to that, they suggested something as six basic emotions. So when we talk about the six basic emotions, these are fear, disgust, anger, sadness, surprise, happiness. So these are six emotions, and although contempt was added a little later, but we still considered as six. And these are considered universally applicable. So universally applicable, it's common to all cultures. Now, Charles Darwin at the later time suggested about emotion. He also did a lot of research, stated that the evolutionary perspective of emotion states that primary emotion has their base in the evolutionary part of life. So during the evolution and at the time of evolution, when we all, you know, the early men type, and we were evolving from early men and moving towards the cognitive part, the erect thumb, etc. They stated that people from different cultures are able to recognize different emotions from their facial expressions. Why? Because we all have evolved differently because we are belonging from different cultures. So the evolutionary perspective suggests that the primary emotions have their base in the evolution, and the evolution is different in every culture. And that's how we interpret emotions different in other cultures. Like, you know, smiling in outside countries at strangers is a very common feature. It's a very welcoming feature. We smile randomly in India to people around. People find it very shocking. People find it very weird and think that, oh, I don't know them. Why are they smiling at me? So remember how facial expressions are recognized different in different cultures in terms of their evolutionary process. Now, moving to understanding, you know, there's a state when we talk about what emotion can be. Let's understand in terms of proper definition given by psychologist. Mishra stated that emotion is a state of being moved and stirred. Ideally, emotion does state that. Emotion is your feelings in motion. So your feelings are moving with you. So even Mishra stated the same concept. Mishra stated that a state of being moved and stirred up or behaviorally aroused or on experiencing an emotional situation, which involves both physiological changes in your body, which can be biological, which is internal, and it could be external. So biological changes external could be your body sweating, tremors in the body. So what do we understand emotion according to Mishra? He suggests it's a state of being moved, stirred, behaviorally being aroused and experiencing an emotional situation that brings about physiological changes, both internal and external. Now, another Feldman stated that it's a feeling that generally has both physiological and cognitive elements which can influence behavior, which is very true. Let's take an example when you have a fight with a friend. It's not only your physiological changes where you're getting angry, where you want to vent out very strongly, but also your thinking, reasoning, which is going at the back of the mind, which is why my friend is behaving like that. Is my perception about him, he or her, changing now with the passage of time? So while you are having an argument, remember, it's not just the physiological changes which are leading to hormonal changes in the body, but also your thinking, reasoning, your attention, your memory from the past, which is actually influencing your behavior at that point of time. That's why during fights, you know, people are remembering instances from their past. They're memorizing and recalling, which influences their behavior. Because they get to know, oh my God, this similar thing happened with me even before. So this is what we speak about as influencing your behavior. Now let's move to a understanding of emotion. You can see some pictures here, and they are not basic emotions. There are many emotions of kids that we find, and see how facial expressions actually differ in terms of making us understand different kinds of emotions. So there's happiness, there's sadness, there's excitement, there's shy, there's jealousy. These are not the basic emotions, but these are holistically many emotions that you see in us. So it is boredom, it's surprise, it's being hopeful, it's being guilty, being excited, afraid, jealous, being loved, being scared. So this completes with a whole lot of cluster of emotions that you can see on board. Let's move to another topic that suggests types of emotions. As we did, we just now do it in, you know, in a huger pattern. Let's explain all of them, which are the basic emotions that we have. The first basic emotion is happiness. Happiness is a feeling of joy. It's the feeling of feeling safe, contentment, being satisfied with something that you have, feeling very pleasured. Now then we talk about fear. These are all basic emotions that we are doing. These six are basic emotions. Then we talk about fear. Fear is any situation that induces a sense of terror, making you feel afraid of something, making you feel, fear is very important for survival. We all need to know we fear, that's why we are competing somewhere. But it usually arouses a lot of stress in the body, so, and panic also. So it is characterized by, a terror in one's well-being, that this is leading to incapacitating me in the future time. So I need to deal with it. It creates a lot of fear. That's why there's a lot of sense of insecurity when we get into relationships. People fear losing people and they end up fighting. That leads to increase their fear, leads to a lot of panic, leads to a huge amount of stress. Then is sadness. Sadness is another very, an emotion which is found very easily in people. It's a feeling of discomfort. It's a feeling of grief. It's also a feeling of heartbrokenness when you feel sad about things. And there'll be features like feeling miserable, gloomy. That's why people tend to feel most sad during winters, because it's very gloomy. It's very dark. It makes you keep very unhappy and low on the lower side of emotions. Then we move to something which is anger. Anger is also at times aroused because we are unable to reach towards our goal, which is frustration. Frustration leads to aggression. We've already studied this. So when people, feel very, very hurt, they feel very, there is something which is no justice has been provided to me, and they feel trapped. They feel the fact that I probably cannot move out of this. What are they getting physically hurt? People are physically hurting them or mentally hurting them. That's what arouses frustration and further leads to aggression. Then we have something as surprise. Surprise is a very small emotion, stays for a very short amount of time. That's why it's called a brief emotion. When we feel shocked in a good way, and it could be in a good and bad way both, it's quite intense, very short-lived. It's like a response to a stimulus that you see suddenly. So it can be both pleasant and unpleasant. Then we move to something which is disgust. Disgust is a situation or environment which is that holds a lot of repulsion. You don't want to be a part of it. And it could be because of unhygienic conditions. It could be because of unhygienic people. You know, at times what happens is we do not like people. People are not alike us. And it could also be because of differences of thought. It could also be emotionally conflicting thoughts that we have. You feel repulsive and disgusted the way the other person thinks. So it could be, again, psychological and physiological. It could be because of hygienic conditions, you know, bad unhygienic areas, small clumsy areas which can make you feel very disgusted, nauseated. And then when it's on the emotional level, it can make you feel disturbed, make you defended. It can make you feel very uncomfortable. So these are six basic emotions. Let's move to an understanding of the functions of emotions and the components. See, why do we have emotions? It directs your behavior. It's extremely important. And another, and it's paramount to human behavior. You need emotions to have an influence of it on your behavior. Without that, we are going to be so robotic. So emotion plays a very important role in shaping your behavior. Also, it prepares you for something. So you know that this is a happy, I'm going to a party and everyone's going to be happy. So my actions and my behaviors are needed to be like this. So it gives you preparation. It influences your behavior, also shapes your future behavior. If you behaved in a particular way and you felt it's wrong, it will help you shape your behavior further. Also, emotion is very, very essential when you're interacting with people. A conversation, probably an argument, a conversation, an interpersonal dealing without emotion is very hollow. You do not have an effective, constructive conversation without emotion, without that feel of being a part of it. Then we have components of emotional process. What are the components we need to know? Its subcomponents can also be seen as features. Emotions are very subjective in nature. What is seen happiness in me can be seen as being surprised in somebody else. And it comprises of both thoughts and action. Your emotion can trigger a lot of thought and that thought can lead towards an action. It does bring about bodily changes. We all know when we are very happy, you know, dopamine comes into, the happy hormone comes out and it keeps you feel, you know, there's a free floating feeling in the body, which keeps you, you know, all happy and all, up moving forward towards a situation, which is very upward towards a situation. At the same time, when you're disgusted, when you're sad at that point of time, you know, there are bodily changes also. You do not have taste in your taste buds. You do not feel nice about things. You feel very rejected in most of the situations. So these are all internal changes also that impacts. Also, it's when we talk about components, response to emotion is also something which is a component of the emotional process. Emotions are coming into play as a response also in a situation. At times just smiling, at times just feeling angry. That's also, you know, coming in the form of responses. And one of the most important is cognitive appraisal. This is one of the most important, and I'm doing it as last is because it's important. This is the first component of emotion, which is called cognitive appraisal. It suggests, there's a theory also of Lazarus, which is not mentioned in your book, but there's a theory of Lazarus of emotion, which emotional process, which suggests that, you know, at times when we are talking about appraisals, if you appraise your emotions, you know, which is like if you think about your emotions, if you think about things very nicely, your emotions are going to work accordingly. So let's take an example of cognitive appraisal of a situation. You thought this situation is going to be amazing. I'm going to have a great day. Your emotions are going to work in a way that make you feel good the entire day. So once you get up in the morning and you have this feeling that, okay, my day is going to be horrible today, remember, that's going to make you give the same sort of a feeling that you've labeled it, you appraised it thinking, reasoning that it is going to be bad. So here the situation is assessed on the basis of your cognitive appraisal, the way you appraise it, the way you emote. So that finishes with this. Now let's do a little bit of difference, which is very quick, but very important. Are moods and emotions different? Yes, they are. Emotions are short-lived. Mood are a longer occurrence of it, and it usually keeps going on at the back. It's a very background thing of your conscious that lasts for a longer duration. And emotions have a cause. It's a clear cause. I'm happy because I have this. And they're very short-lived also. And at the same time, they happen for a minute. They happen for a few seconds. So emotions like feeling of love, feeling of anger, and mood is very different. That feeling of love, of that feeling of sadness, gives you sadness, gloominess for a while. and the mood will stay like that for a longer duration. So it's like a background. So if you're surrounded by black walls, imagine that's the mood, and what you feel at that point is emotion. So that short-lived feeling, fear, it's emotion, and that, in, you know, that eloping wall which is black is something which is the mood. Longer in duration, at the background, staying on for a longer period of time, emotions, very short-lived, has a cause, very clear. Then let's come to, is there a difference between emotions and feelings too? Yes, there is. Emotions are very complex. They keep changing and they're very subjective. They have an affective process. It's basically affective process, which is emotions are having a cause, and having a cause, it's also very subjective. Well, and objective too. At times we can quantify it and we can tell people, and it can vary all the time. Feelings are always very subjective. It keeps floating up and down. So emotions can be labeled mostly. Feelings, there are some sort of feelings that are unable to make you speak. So these are feelings that you cannot verbalize. 10 things in the mind, and the emotion is fear. 10 things in the mind, and the emotion is anger. 10 things in the mind, and the emotion is excitedness. But you probably cannot verbalize it as feelings because it's very subjective. It's always very subjective. It keeps fluctuating. And obviously, remember, when we talk about emotion, emotion does bring about physiological changes more often. Feelings will make you think, but emotions will make you think and change physiologically too. So on a bigger term, emotion is more constructive and more objective subjective, whereas feelings are something which is way, way too subjective. Keep moving like this all the time, keeps changing and fluctuating more than emotions. So this finishes with the differences that we have. Let's quickly do the theories. I'll continue it also. We probably will not be able to finish with time, but let's do the first theory of emotions. It's a beautiful theory and a very simple theory that we have. This is given by Jameson Lang. And William James and Danish Lang, which was, a Danish physician, which was Carl Lang, that's why it's called a James Lang theory. You'll always hear it from people as James Lang theory. It's a very simple theory of emotion. It suggests that, they propose that when an emotion is felt, as soon as there's a situation that you have, the first thing that happens to our body is the physiological changes that leads to production of the emotion. So it's very simple. We experience bodily changes that further produces an emotion. So we react to a situation bodily and that creates emotion. So here the passage starts from the example that I've given. I'm sure it's on the page. You see a dog, there's a sense of palpitation. You know, your sympathetic nervous system blasts away. As soon as the dog howls at you, you start, there's an increase of heart rate, blood rate, respiration is high. And then there's a sudden emotion. You label it as, okay, it's fear. I need to run away from you. So that is something, the most simplest theory that you have of James Lang would suggest that first there's a stimulus. You react to the stimulus, which brings about bodily changes. And this bodily changes leads to production of emotions. So this is what is James Lang theory. A very simple theory that emotions that we feel are a result of the bodily changes that happen to us. So bodily changes are manifesting emotions. Now let's move to an opposite theory, which was given by Cannonball. Cannonball proposed a little different theory here. He suggested that the emotion that we feel depends upon the activity of the lower brain. So it's associating to the central nervous system. Suggests that when an emotion is felt, the bodily changes that occurs in response to emotion, the bodily changes, they are so independent of one another that they can occur simultaneously. So the bodily changes and the emotion occur at the same time, this theory suggests. And then, which is followed by an activation of your hypothalamus, which sends the impulse from the internal organ and they express the emotion. So according to them, there's a stimulus and the two things happens together. Physiological changes, which is sympathetic nervous system getting aroused, and the fear getting labeled, okay, this is fear, which leads to understand the brain that you need to run away from here. So recognition of the fear. So it says, it starts, probably an image can make you, help you understand better. I'll move to the image for you. These are other theories that you play. We might just do till Cannonball theory. The theory was given by Cannonball. I'm moving to the last page again. Cannonball was given by Cannon and Bard. There are two different psychologists that we have. So speaking of Cannonball, they suggested a different thought. There's a stimulus and there are times that the emotion and the physiological process occurs simultaneously. So he starts experiencing fear and there is sympathetic nervous system functioning at the same rate, which is heart rate increase, blood rate, respiration increases, and what happens? It moves towards recognition of fear. This Hypothalamus signals are sent, sensory signals, hypothalamus receives it, motor nerves, this is fear. So the expression, which is the final port, is the last thing. Now let's see the picture of Cannon Bard that you see here. Again, there's a dog. See the body response and the fear, subjective experience that I'm experiencing fear happens. But last is something which that we talk about expression. Expression is the last thing over here. So I hope this is simple. James Lyon suggested that we have a stimulus and we have a physiological response that leads to emotion. Here, they state that there is a stimulus and the physiological response and the emotion is coming together, and then there is an expression. Expression would be probably my heart is pounding, I run away. So probably running away would be the last thing that you happen. Then there's another theory which is called the single scatter theory. This is also called the two-factor theory because it takes care of a lot of things. It will take care of body arousal and it will take care of interpretation, which is interpreting the body arousal. What is it? The cognition, which will further label you the fear. So that's why it's called a two-factor theory, because it involves two factors coming in a row, which is a very simple thing that you have. So emotion are as a result of the interpretation of the emotion that you've done, of the arousal. So it has a sequence. Let's take an example. You actually see a dog which is very, very, very furious, and it's barking at you horrendously. It's making you feel very uncomfortable. So it's barking continuously. What does the body do? Now there's a body change. There is arousal of the body. There is sympathetic nervous system. You start sweating at the same time. There's pounding of heart. So what is happening? This bodily arousal is interpreted. Now you interpret the arousal and you experience an emotional state. Okay, this is fear. I am not feeling very comfortable in front of this dog. I need to move away. It's very fearful. The dog looks very scary. So that's what happens here. So see, in the picture which is next to you, which we will finish with this only today, let's take common sense what happens. Whenever we see something which is, let's take an example, you go to a zoo. You're looking at a lion from a distance, and then suddenly the lion, like, or the tiger comes to you rushing. Subjective experience, you start getting fearful, and then bodily changes are experienced by you. Usually that happens. We run away and then we start sweating. But James Lyon said the opposite. James Lyon stated that you have a stimulus, there is a bodily arousal that leads to emotion. Cannon Bard is of the simultaneous thought. There is a stimulus and the subjective interpretation and the bodily arousals are happening at the same time. So you're recognizing emotion and bodily changes happen at the same time. And then expressions, because you express it, because the information is sent to the hypothalamus. And it's more physiological in nature, because it is sending information to the central nervous system also. The last for single scatter, very correctly, it's a two-factor theory. It's a two-factor theory because here we are involving two things. You see a stimulus, your body starts making changes. Like, let's take a good example. You see someone that you really love and you meet them. The body arousal, the body is feeling happy, there are goosebumps in the body, and there's a sudden smile coming onto face, and the interpretation is, okay, I'm really happy when I see this person. So this is what? This is interpretation, which is leading to a emotion. So this is how these theories are different, which completes all of our theories today, leaving behind the facial feedback hypothesis and cognitive meditational theory. When we talk about facial feedback, it suggests that facial expressions are, as Charles Darwin stated, is universal in nature, in all culture, not influenced by culture, it's universal in nature. So your facial expression actually expresses the kind of emotion. So if you feel surprised, your emotion, that's a feeling of surprise. If you feel smiling all the time, it's an expression that you are happy today. And cognitive meditational suggests that, this is given by Lazarus, emphasize that the role of appraisal, which the theory I was talking about, the way you appraise the emotion is the way you express it. If you've appraised that the situation is happy, you appraise it to be a happy situation. This completes with our knowledge today. And it also says that we have some measurements of emotion that we continue in the next. I have given you it on the page so that we continue with it. There are some non-verbal instruments and there are some questionnaires which are called self-report measures. We will continue with this. Hope the class was very understandable for all of you. We completed with motivation and emotions today. We have completed with the theories of emotions also. Hope it was great to all of you. Thank you so much, everyone. And we will continue with our class the next time. Thank you so much. Namaste.